فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today is going to be the last day for the introduction of مدخل إلى علم الفقه. We're going to do the last and the final madhab, madhab al-Zahiri. So we previously spoke about madhab al-Maliki, and we spoke about madhab al-Hanafiya, madhab al-Shafi'iyya, and we also finally spoke about madhab al-Hanbaliyya. Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to speak about the last madhab that is followed, which is al-madhab al-zahiri. As we always do, we define and we speak about the imam of the madhab. This is the fifth madhab according to Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. The head of this madhab and the leader of this madhab, his name is Dawud ibn Ali ibn Khalaf. Dawud ibn Ali ibn Khalaf. You can either say Asbahani, or you could say, if you want, Asfahani. So you can say it as a ba, or you can say it as a fa. So Al Asbahani or Al-Asfahani. And he's very well known as Dawud al-Zahiri is what he's known as. He's very well known as Dawud al-Zahiri. He was born the year 204 Hijriya, and he died 270 Hijriya. The person who spread this madhab, who really pushed it, who spread it around the earth, really defended it, safeguarded it, is none other than Al-Imam Ibn Hazm Al-Zahiri. His name is Abu Muhammad Ali Ibn Ahmad Ibn Sa'id Ibn Hazm. His name is Abu Muhammad Ali Ibn Ahmad Ibn Sa'id Ibn Hazm. He was born the year 384, and he died the year 456 Hijriya. So Abu Dawud al-Zahiri's madhab, if it wasn't for Allah and then Ibn Hazm, his madhab wouldn't really have become something. And it would have been graded and classified as the madahibs that came and left. That's what we would have thought, we would have seen it. Like the Ibn Jarir's madhab, Sufyan al-Thawri's madhab, Awza'i's madhab, Layth ibn Sa'ad's madhab. These a'imma, they were fuqaha. Their madhab went. They went. Like in Abu Muhammad, Ali ibn Hazm, he pushed Abu Dawud al-Zahiri's madhab. And it became really known and acknowledged. And Abu Muhammad Ali ibn Ahmad ibn Sa'id ibn Hazm, he was born the year 384, and he died the year 456. Dawud al-Zahiri, the Imam of this madhab, in his early stages, or let's say his first steps, or the first madhab that he studied was, he took madhab al-Shafi'i. So he was a Shafi'i in his early stages. He took it from Abu Thawr. Abu Thawr, who is one of the students of who? He's one of the students of Imam al-Shafi'i. In where, like in? Where is he a student of Imam al-Shafi'i in? Baghdad, we spoke about that. Then Abu Dawud al-Zahiri, رحل إلى نيسابور. Abu Dawud al-Zahiri, he traveled from Baghdad after that and he went to Naysabur. Then he sought knowledge there. He took it from the ulama of Naysabur. And then he came back to Baghdad. When he came back to Baghdad, he made apparent, he brought to light his view regarding analogy, qiyas. And he proved and he brought out that he negates qiyas. And he doesn't believe in the existence of qiyas. And he also rejected other types of dalalatul alfad. He rejected it. And then what he did was, he clearly brought out into the open that he only takes the apparent verses and he only takes the apparent ahadith. He just takes it from the bahir. And so he rejected many of the dalalat that you would find in Kutub Usul al-Fiqh, like Mabhath al-Mufhum. He doesn't take it. It has to be mantuq. Mafhum, whether it's mafhum al-awla or mafhum al-muwafaqa or mafhum mukhalafa, he doesn't care for him. He doesn't take mafhum at all. It's the chapters that he rejects. He also rejects qiyas, analogy. Doesn't believe in qiyas. And many other things that he rejected. So what does he say that he takes? Why is his madhab called madhab al-zahiri? What's the zahiri? It means he takes the zahir, he takes the apparent verses. And what does he also take? The apparent ahadith. So like for example, if a woman says, when her father asks, and she's a virgin, and her father asks her, do you want to get married? If she says, yes, dad, for him that's not permissible to marry her off. Because the narration said that her silence is acceptance. If she speaks, it's not an acceptance. Because he takes the apparent evidences. The hadith clearly, apparently says from the zahir, from the apparent, what did it say? That she say yes. Good. Kitab al-Muhalla by Ibn Hazm. The book Kitab al-Muhalla by Ibn Hazm is the Diwanu al-Fiqh al-Zahiri, is the reference point for the Zahiri Madhab. This book, Al-Muhalla, written by Ibn Hazm, is the book that's considered a reference point, a very extraordinary, great reference point for the Zahiri Madhab. And as it was said, لَوْلَا الْمُحَلَّى, if it wasn't for the Muhalla by Ibn Hazm, لَمَاتَ فِقْهُ الظَّاهِرِي, فِقْهُ الظَّاهِرِي would have died. This fiqh and this madhab would have died. لِأَنَّهُ, the reason is because لَمْ يُشْهَرْ لَهُ تَلَمِيد, none of his students, Abu Dawud al-Zahiri, became famous and out there. So if it wasn't for this book, Al-Muhalla, it wouldn't have been a madhab that would be studied or even looked into. Here's a question now. It's a big discussion amongst the ulama, and that is, and this qadiyah is a qadiyah to that shan. Don't take this matter very lightly, which is, هَلْ يُعْتَبَرُ خِلَافُ الظَّاهِرِيَّةِ, is the خِلَافُ الظَّاهِرِيَّةِ actually taken into consideration? If they differ, so imagine all the other four imams, they agree on something. And let's say all of the ulama agree on something, مثلاً. If the ظاهريه oppose them, is their difference of opinion or their disagreement, is it actually taken into consideration? Is it given any weight? Does that make sense? Also, is their madhab, the madhab al-ظاهري, is it a madhab يُنظر إليه في الخلاف? For example, we remember we spoke at the early stages of the madkhal ila ilm al-fiqh, the early stages we spoke about that the person needs to look at the difference of opinion of the scholars, especially in issues of fiqh, because you don't want to speak about a matter where you haven't really looked at the difference of opinion there are. Does that make sense? You want to look at each party, their disagreement, why they disagree, what's their evidences, and etc. So the question is, do we have to look into the madhab al-zahiri, their difference of opinion or their disagreement? Is it something that we should give any consideration? Very important question. From the scholars, the Ahlul Ilm, من ذهب إلى أن خلاف الظاهرية, from the scholars of the people of knowledge, There are those who considered that the khilaf of the Zahiriyyah لا يعتد به, it should not be given any weight. Some scholars, they hold the opinion that the madhab al-Zahiriyyah, the madhab al-Zahiriyyah should not be given any weight, and that their statement, it should not be added to the ranks of the statements of the fuqaha, and the jurists. And their reason for this is because they say that the Zahiriyyah reject qiyas, and qiyas is a ruknu fil ijtihad. Qiyas is a pillar in what? In independent reasoning. When a person wants to deduct a ruling, he need to do qiyas. He need to do ijtihad, and he can't do independent reasoning if he hasn't what? If he hasn't studied qiyas, and if he doesn't believe in qiyas. So if they don't accept qiyas, then they're not what? They're not mujtahideen. They're not people who can do independent reasoning, because they're rejecting the pillar in which ijtihad stands on. ولذلك الإمام الشافعي, he said, as الإمام الخطيب البغدادي narrated from him in his kitab الفقيه والمتفقي, شافعي said, القياس هو الاجتهاد. Shafi'i actually said that qiyas is ijtihad. If you want to know what ijtihad is, it's actually qiyas. It's one and the other thing. Good. Also from the scholars who said that is Imam al-Nawawi in his kitab al-Majmu', which is a sharh of Muhaddab Abi Layyab Ishaq al-Shirazi. He also said that in his kitab sharh al-Sunnah, sharh Sahih Muslim, sorry. Sharh Sahih Muslim. الإمام النووي. And an Imam al-Nawawi is from the scholars who believe that the madhab al-Zahiriyya are not what? Their khilaf la yu'tadu bihim. That their difference of opinion should not be given consideration. Because of the fact that they go against this very, very strong point. Are we all together? The second view is بعض العلماء, some of the scholars who believe أن الظاهرية, that the madhab الظاهرية يعتد بخلافهم, their difference of opinion is given consideration, it's given weight, it is, ويذكر قولهم, and their statement should be mentioned. And some of the scholars of the madhab الحنبلي, the بعض الحنابلة, some of the حنابلة, they mention that the statement of ظاهرية يعتد به بخلافهم. Their khilaf is given weight and it's given consideration. And what seems to be apparent? What seems to be apparent, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, is that أن فقهاء الظاهرية, that the فقهاء and the jurists of the ظاهري madhab يؤخذ بقولهم, that their statement should be taken, and that their khilaf should be given weight and it should be given a consideration. Unless, if they oppose in what? If they oppose in a matter related to qiyas. Okay? But if the thing that has been discussed is a matter pertaining to a dalil, okay, then this issue, it shouldn't have any, what do you call it? Reason why their statement should be given. There shouldn't be any reason or shouldn't be anything that stops us from giving weight to their statement. So this is the what? This is the madhab of Abu Dawood al-Zahiriyyu rahimahullah. I want to conclude inshallah ta'ala with two very powerful points inshallah ta'ala. The first one is, as you all know, soon, inshallah ta'ala, Egypt book fair is going to start. It's going to start when? The 27th, taqriban, 26th, 27th of January. So two things for a person who wants to study fiqh, two very important things. Number one is that (clears throat) that the person buys the following books to study and ground themselves in the madhab, fiqh, to ground themselves in fiqh, that the person or the student of knowledge should give iqtina, consideration to getting the following books. Al-Mabsut, that's written by Imam Sarakhsi, sorry. Or we can say Sarakhsi, we mentioned that before. Al-Mabsut, that is written by Sarakhsi. And the person, he adds on to the first kitab that a student of knowledge, instead of going out buying so many fiqh books and contemporary books and Rasail Jami'iyya, just busy yourself with these ummahat, these important books. The first of them is Al-Mabsut. And it's written by Al-Imam As-Sarakhsi. Add on that the Kitab Fath al-Qadir. The Kitab Fath al-Qadir, written by Ibn Hammam. Kamal Ibn Hammam. Also the Kitab Bada'i' al-Sana'i' by Kasani. Or the Kitab Al-Bahru al-Ra'iq, written by Ibn Nujaym. If the person adds on to that as well, the Hashi of Ibn Abidin, then that would be very good. Are we all together? Those were all the Hanafi books. Those were all Hanafi books. As for the Madhab al-Malikiyya, if the person can buy the Muwatta of Imam Malik, rahimahullah, and the person tries to get the Kitab al-Tamheed Ibn Abd al-Barr, which is a sharah of the Muwatta Imam Malik, so you try to get the Muwatta, the matan by itself, with the tahqiq of Bashar Awad Ma'roof. It's the best tahqiq. The Muwatta, yeah, he done tahqiq of it. Just the matan of the hadith. The Muwatta of Imam Malik. And then the student and the person then goes, and what do they try to get? Then they try to get the Tamheed written by Ibn Abd al-Barr. And also Bashar Awad Ma'roof did tahqiq on the Kitab al-Tamheed written by Ibn Abd al-Barr. He did tahqiq of it. Also, if the person can get the four books that's good. As for the Madhab al-Shafi'iyyah, if the person can get go back. So what did we say? The Muwatta of Imam Malik, and then we said the Tamheed Ibn Abd al-Barr, right? Then the person should try to also get the shuruh, the explanations that are put on the Mukhtasar al-Khalil. And one of the shuruh is al-Risala, right? Also go to the Madhab al-Shafi'i, try to get the Muwatta of Imam Malik. Al-Imam Malik is Muwatta. Also try to get the Majmu', which is the sharah of the Mukhtasar, sharah, which is the Muhaddab li Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi, the Majmu' by Nawawi, and the Rawdatu al-Talibin by Nawawi rahimahullah. And last but not least, the Minhaj al-Nawawi. The Madhab al-Hanafiyya, Madhab al-Hanabila, the Hanbali Madhab, try to get the Mughni by Ibn Qudama, which is the sharah of Mukhtasar al-Khiraqi. Add on to that the Insaf written by Al-Mardawi, and the Mubdi' by Ibn Muflih, and the Kafi by Ibn Qudama, and the Muntaha al-Iradat by Al-Futuhi. All of those, if you get them, it will be very good. So you get the Mughni by Ibn Qudama, the Insaf by Mardawi, the Mubdi' by Ibn Muflih, the Kafi by Ibn Qudama, and the muntaha al-iradat. Muntaha al-iradat by futuhi, that would be good. In the madhab al-zahiri, if you buy the kitab, the muhalla al-ibn Hazm, then that's good, that suffices you. This is a maktaba musaghara. It's a very baby, small maktaba. It's a very small library that you've started. And these are the books that a lot of the statements of the ulama and their discussion revolves around. So these are books that are necessary that the talib al-ilm should have. We're not talking about other, we're not saying this is all you need. Nah, you need more if you enhance. But these are what? A small student of knowledge's library. The second point that I want to speak about, inshaAllah ta'ala, is بإذن الله الكريم, as a conclusion of this madkhal, is how should one become a faqih? How can a person be a strong faqih? The first advice that I can give you is for a person to become a faqih, and it's the key to become a faqih, is that the person strives hard to memorize the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. على حفظ القرآن الكريم, memorizing the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not forsake the book of Allah and do not dismiss it. And place for the Qur'an a portion of your time. And the best time is the last third of the night. For verily that's the time that has the most barakah, to memorize the Qur'an. And your memorization becomes grounded at that particular time. You see amazement if you were to get up and read at that particular time. You place for yourself a portion of the Qur'an that you memorized. You set yourself that portion. If it's half a page, if it's 2 pages, if it's 3 lines, if it's a line, just be consistent with it. And try to memorize the Qur'an. Because that is the key of fiqh. Because fiqh firstly revolves around what statement and whose words? Statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I advise you first, and ta'atani ya ikhwati al-kiram, that you give consideration to bihifdh al-Qur'an al-kareem. The second thing that helps you become a faqih is an tahris, that you strive hard, ala al-tila'i ala kutub al-sunnah, that you try to read. If you're not going to memorize it, at least you try to read the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And especially you try to read the ahadith al-ahkam, which a student of knowledge requires and he needs. You're always looking at it and you're always reading it, such as Sunan Abi Dawud, Sunan al-Nisa'i, Sunan Ibn Majah, you see, and Sunan al-Tirmidhi. And you try to also read the Bulugh al-Maram min Adillat al-Ahkam, written by Hafiz Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. You also try to read the kitab Umdatul Ahkam by Abdul Ghani, Abdul Wahid Al-Maqdisi, Rahimahumullahu Jami'an. Those are books that speak about Hadith Al-Ahkam. You also try to look at the Sunan of Daraqutni. You look at the Sunan Al-Bayhaqi. You try to also look at the Muntaqa by Abu al-Barakat, Ibn Taymiyyah. You look at these kutubs that consist of and only talk about Hadith Al-Ahkam. You look at them consistently, you go over them. The third thing that would help you, and it is the key to becoming a faqih, and it's the path to become a person who's grounded in fiqh, it's to place a correct methodology for yourself. Methodology is very important. What book are you going to start from and what book are you going to finish at? So you start from a matan, a small book that's small, that's easy. You start from that and you make your way up gradually. And alhamdulillah, we've already chosen the kitab, Matnu Abi Shuja'. And that's a kitab which is mukhtasar, small. And inshaAllah ta'ala, bit tadarruj. If we gradually go up and up and up, inshaAllah ta'ala, you will see yourself becoming tough and strong in fiqh. And one of the reasons why people tend to not be able to attain any science within the religion is the fact that they lack ikhtiyar al-matn al-munasib. choosing the most befitting book about what methodology that they need to take. A lot of people, they lack that. And because that is not there, they spend a year or two confused how to seek knowledge. And so when they don't see no fruits of their coming to classes every day, and they're sitting around, when they don't see no substance coming from it, they give up and they look for a 9-to-5 job. So it's very important. اختيار, choosing المتن المناسب. Choosing the right method and having a correct methodology. Inshallah ta'ala, that is something we are working hard on in making sure that all of you are going to get the correct books. The fourth thing that will help you inshallah ta'ala is اتباع الطريقة الصحيحة. Following the right path في القراءة when it comes to reading. When you're reading fiqh and you're going over the books of fiqh that we mentioned, you don't read them like a storybook. No. Fiqh is not read, لا يقرأ هذًا. It's not read like that. Rather, it's read with analyzation, observation. And the reason why this subject was specifically called fiqh is because it requires fiqh. It requires fahm. It requires understanding. So the person needs to read in a way where he's understanding and he's digesting the information. And how does that happen? Is that the person, he takes the mas'ala that the scholars are talking about and that the scholars are discussing. And what do you try to do to it? Is that mas'ala, after you've understood it and you know what is meant by it, you try to open i'tiradat. You try to open oppositions on it, disagreement with it. And then what you try to do is you try to respond to the i'tiradat, the opposition that you might come with. Or you try your best to go to shuruh and explanations regarding that particular issue. And then look for somebody who has actually brought forward this opposition that you've brought forward. And this is one of the ways that strengthens a person's understanding of al-fiqh. And there are many other ways also a person can do it. I've already spoken about that when I was talking about the precision in knowledge. I spoke about that when I was speaking about precision in knowledge. Last but not least, the fifth point that inshaAllah ta'ala that will help you be grounded in fiqh and become strong is making sure that you make consistent dua. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told to say, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Say, O Muhammad, O Allah, increase me in knowledge. So if the Prophet was told to make dua for Allah to increase him in knowledge, then what we need to know and we need to understand is we will never attain knowledge unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to know. ولذلك الشيخ الإسلام used to say, يَا مُعَلِّمَ دَاوُودَ عَلِّمْنِي وَيَا مُفَهِّمَ سُلَيْمَانَ فَهِمْنِي. Shaykh al-Islam, who is Shaykh al-Islam, used to say, the one who taught Dawood, teach me, and the one that made Sulaiman understand, allow me to understand. So the person has to humble himself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and beg him and raise his hands up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, will give you what you're asking for. Because what you've done is you've taken the asbab, you've come with the means, and you've also humbled yourself and asked the Lord of the heavens and the earth to help you and aid you in treading on this path and attaining beneficial knowledge. That's inshaAllah ta'ala the amount that we want to take from the madhhab al-zahiri that we needed today. We have now concluded inshaAllah ta'ala the madkhal ila ilm al-fiqh that we needed. And what we took and the points that we discussed over the last couple of months was the following. We spoke about the first point, qadiyah that we spoke about, the first point that we spoke about was we defined fiqh. And when we define fiqh, we defined it linguistically, we defined it technically, and we also defined it according to every scholar of every different field, what he saw as to be fiqh. Then the second point we moved on to, which is we spoke about khilaf. We defined what khilaf means. We spoke about the difference between khilaf and ikhtilaf. We also spoke about the difference between khilaf and jadal. And we also spoke about the difference between khilaf, jadal, and shiqaq. We also even spoke about what is a accepted khilaf. We also spoke about haqiqat wuqu' al-khilaf fi al-ummah, the reality of khilaf occurring in this ummah. We also spoke about, in that point, wuqu' al-khilaf ya'udu ila umurin. What does khilaf occurring go back to? What's the source for it? Or what's the reason that it comes? We also spoke about, is a khilaf something we need to look for? Is it an objective that the Sharia is trying to attain? Or is it something that comes about? We also spoke about the types of khilaf, and we categorized them in many different angles. We looked at it. We also spoke about what causes the scholars and the fuqaha to have khilaf. Then we moved on to the third point. The third point we spoke about tariqul fiqh. And when we spoke about tariqul fiqh, here's where we spoke about marahilu tariqul fiqh, the levels and the stages which fiqh went through. And we said fiqh went through how many stages? We said it went through six stages. Seven stages, huh? Yeah? No. Seven marahil, tariq, it went through. Seven marahil, seven levels. We mentioned. We also talked about dhuhur al-ijtihad al-jama'i. How later in this ummah, there came ijtihad which was communal. Majami'an, lajnat came, lajna this, lajna that, majma' this, majma' that. That the ijtihad, it used to be individuals, now it became what? A communal ijtima' and a communal ijtihad. And we spoke about the conditions that are stipulated for a person to become a faqih. We spoke about that. Then we went into the first qadiyah, the issue of a tamadhub, following a madhab, and the views regarding that. And should a person follow a madhab or should he not? We spoke about that. Then we went into the four madhabs that are followed, each one and how it came about, and the stages that it went through, and also the terms and the istilahat that are used in each madhab, and books pertaining to madhabs. So we did that for the madhab al-Hanafi, we did that for the madhab al-Maliki, we also spoke about that in madhab al-Shafi'i, and also the madhab al-Hanbali. Each imam of the madhab we spoke about. And we also spoke about al-madhab al-zahiri, which was the last one today. And we concluded with a khatima. The khatima that we concluded with was two things. Today, which is al-maktabatul faqih, the maktaba, the library of a small student of fiqh. What does he need to place in his library? We mentioned the books that he needs from each madhab. And we also mentioned the last thing that we concluded with was what path should a person take in order to attain fiqh and then in order to learn fiqh. And we mentioned how many things? Five things that he needs to come with if he wants to learn fiqh. Insha'Allah ta'ala, next lesson, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, we will start Matn Abi Shuja'. Start with Kitab al-Tahara, Babu al-Miyah. We'll start with the chapter of Tahara, and we'll start on the chapter of water, inshallah ta'ala. Bi'idhnillahi al-Kareem. Anything which I have said today that was wrong and incorrect, slip of the tongue, fault, error, is from me, a shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. And anything which I've said also in the whole sessions on this whole Muqaddimah is also from me and Shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.